think you're ready for my rhymes? You'll soon be green as envious limes. I see you're not yellow, fellow, but I don't want to make you blue. So get a clue and purple the fluff before you played, or I'll arrange a rainbow on your brain.
Yeah, thanks, Dave. Yeah, I'll give you 5.
Really?
I'll give you 5.5.
Yeah, I thought that was better when I read it the second time. Like,
all right, guys, welcome to this week's Grimerica show. I'm Darren Grimes. With me, as always, is your elitist puppet, Graham Dunlop. How's it going this week, scumbag?
My elitist what? Puppet?
Your elitist puppet.
Oh, my God. Yeah, I'm doing well, buddy.
Just well?
Just well.
We've done that before. Just well? How come? You look like you're having a good time.
I've been talking for 4 hours, so.
So you should be doing great.
Actually, if you include work, I've been talking for 16 hours. So.
See, you should just channel that.
Oh, I am. Didn't you know?
Into song. Just pick like a couple words out of every day and make a song.
Okay. I'll do that.
So we got Emy Bitner and Alex Teplish, double interview. They're both pretty long too, so you guys, this will be a good one.
Yeah, artists, comic, graphic novel artists.
Yeah, not just artists, but yeah, they do all the writing and everything.
Yeah.
Creators. Artists.
Yes. It's good to have creators on the show.
Yeah, it is. It kind of ties into a lot of the stuff we talk about here too, so it's kind of was a no-brainer for us.
Yeah.
RPJJ is going to join us for the Emy Bitner chat, and then we fly solo for the Alex Teplish, which was a fucking mission to get accomplished. I think that one had to get
rescheduled
a few times. Yeah. Crazy occurrences.
Yeah, I mean, this is a thought we had like last fall, I think, about having a little double episode with some artist, you know, talking about fringe genres and their creative comments and stuff. I know, what the fuck you did.
Yeah, and of course, this is our week off. I guess we took a week off while I went to a wedding, so you guys will be hearing this while I'm in Ontario or Manitoba someplace. Graham's probably still somewhere near the igloo.
Working
9 to 5. So yeah, hopefully this all came out as scheduled.
Yes, hopefully. Your timer worked.
Yeah, it'll be a big experiment now, won't it?
I have a synchronicity.
You do?
Yeah.
Yeah, fired up.
That's from a great listener of ours. Is there a jingle or anything like that?
Gitmo.
No jingle?
No.
Okay. What's up, man? This is from David Zary. He says, show's going great. I'm a little behind trying to catch up, though. Just finished one with Dave McGowan. Really good. Interesting, to say the least. I'll be checking out that book for sure. He says, so I had a possible synchronicity just the other day. I was sitting at work playing a game on my phone, one of those games that is like an online game where people from all over the world play.
I like how I've got people nervous enough now that they say possible synchronicities.
Definitely. He says, I was talking with this guy while I was listening to Mysterious Universe, the one about the lecture that Michael Tellinger gave. So this guy and I started talking about that kind of stuff, UFOs, aliens, ancient alternative history, etc. And my curiosity struck, so I asked this guy where he was from, and he was from South Africa, same as Tellinger. Thought this was odd and figured I'd share it with you guys. Not too sure if that would even be considered a synchronicity. Now I'm guessing Darren is going to give me a 5 or 6, or if I'm lucky a 6, but pretty crazy at this point, listening to that certain show, and I happen to be talking to a guy from the same place. I have a couple more synchronicities that have happened, but this one is fresh in my mind. Anyways, keep up the good work. By the way, I think I'm going to become a Raelian. Ha ha ha, not really. He said that one was interesting too, but he doesn't know about all that stuff. Thanks, David.
Yeah, thanks, Dave. Yeah, I'll give you 5.
Really?
I'll give you 5.5.
Yeah, I thought that was better when I read it the second time. Because, like, you know, you don't meet a lot of people from South Africa. South Africa.
No, he manifested them. I'm on a manifestation kick tonight.
Yeah, I know you are. It's crazy.
Actually, technically, Maybe you manifested him.
Who, David?
No. The other guy, the South African guy.
Maybe I was listening to Talented at the same time, which the MU guys were quite harsh on him. It was, I don't know. Like, I like some of it, but yeah, they were pretty, well, actually, they funny had little, some good things to say,
funny
too.
Funny little caveat is that I actually first heard of Dave McGowan when the MU guys were talking about his book briefly, I think.
Really? Wow. Yeah.
That's not a synchronicity.
All this stuff connected isn't.
Don't get all, like, see you get all excited over there. Like, I'm about to have some breakthrough.
Is this the banter that people love? I hope.
Yeah, this must be.
It's real. It's not fake. We don't know what the fuck we're doing here.
I know what I'm doing.
Oh, here it is. Profound UFO
quote of the week. Catching Graham off guard.
Yeah. Fuck, luckily I just have one ready here, and this is Graham's profound UFO synchronicity of the week. Doctor,
oh, wait, what's it called?
You know what it's called. Dr. Robert M. L. Baker, Jr., President of West Coast University, author of two astrodynamics textbooks, head of Lockheed's Astrodynamics Research Center from 1961 to 64, member of the Faculty of Astronomy and Engineering at UCLA from 1959 to 1971. In 1968, he made the following statement concerning the one U.S. radar system in operation that at that time, to his knowledge, exhibited sufficient continuous coverage to reveal UFOs operating above the Earth's atmosphere. The system is partially classified and hence I cannot go into great detail. Since this particular sensor system has been in operation, there have been a number of anomalistic alarms. Alarms that as of...
Anomalistic, this, I like that.
Yeah, anomalistic alarms. That can be our show, like anomalistic.
Oh, there's already a thing called the Anomalist.
Right.
And we already have a name. It's called the Grimerica Show, remember?
Alarms that, as of this date, have not been explained on the basis of natural phenomena interference, equipment malfunction, or inadequacy, or man-made space objects.
What about swamp gas?
That too, buddy. I'll throw that in there. That's
Venus?
That too. That would be considered... that would be considered natural phenomena.
I suppose.
Yes. That's from the 1968 congressional hearings.
What if it's
hearings.
Swamp gas from a septic field?
Man-made.
Man-made slash natural?
Yeah.
Mantural?
That's from the 1968 congressional hearings. Dr. Robert M. L. Baker, Jr.
That was not bad.
Another good one, eh?
That's like a short story. I like them when they're long like that.
Oh, do you? Well, I don't want to, you know, take up too much of your time, so I sometimes pick the short ones.
Well, you're taking it up anyway. You might as well be talking about some quote. Might as well be speaking someone else's words.
That's true. Thanks, buddy.
All right. Do we have... So this will be coming out right before the money bomb draw. So when this comes out, you guys probably have about 3 or 4 days left to get in on the money draw. I think we're... over already, so we'll definitely be giving away some cash. So jump in, grimerica.ca/moneybomb. Consider making a donation, helping us pay the bills, or spreading the word.
Yeah, please help, because of our silly deal at the beginning of this, we give away more than we keep. So we want to get it up to 50-50, like an actual 50-50 draw where we give 50 away and we keep 50 to help out our expenses. So
it'd be nice to have that decision back. Too late now.
Yeah.
Live and learn.
Yeah, but thanks for donating. Thanks for subscribing. It does really help. And
yeah, and review the shit out of the show.
Yeah,
because that helps a lot too.
Yeah,
helps us move up in our categories and stuff like that. So more people stumble upon us, and the more we get the numbers, the more we get the listeners.
That's right.
The more listeners and guests and everything else along the way.
Then guys like Graham Hancock will want to come on our show.
Yeah, they'll be knocking the door down.
Yeah.
Knocking the igloo door down. We don't. Right. Does the igloo have a door?
No, it just has an opening.
An opening? Is there like some beads on it or something? Yeah. Like some peace beads?
Yeah. They just have to bend down and crawl through the little tunnel.
Some Bob Marley playing and some smoke coming out of the chimney. A mailbox that says Grimerica on it.
Does that mean... Does that
you have any spam?
I had a question for you. Well, yeah, I kind of had a question for you because talking about smoke coming out of the igloo, what's this thing called greening out?
When you smoke too much weed.
Is that fucking possible?
Motherfucker gets sick. Yeah, it happened to me back in high school.
Really?
Yeah. Push your tolerance level. It probably has something to do with not eating. I know other people that'll just pass right out, fucking boom, hit the deck, man, and they just get up all woozy and shit.
Hmm. Maybe that's what happened when I puked up a dozen donuts that I ate when I was...
Maybe it's because you ate a dozen fucking donuts.
It's like a big donut. It's a big doughy pile. Just bro.
Just a big doughy mess.
That was when we were 16, and we were wondering why we couldn't light the lighters anymore. Like, why the light? None of the lights would work. And so we were in the back of this Camaro, and there was so much smoke in the air, there wasn't enough oxygen to light the lighters.
Really?
Yeah.
So you're just that close to fucking all just passing out, never waking up.
No, that's greeting out.
That's, yeah, that's, yeah. I don't think that's greeting out.
Oh, boy.
That's fucking Darwinism.
Yeah. That's probably a good sign. I should have stopped back then before I turned like 30,
you'd have been, you guys would have been the first couple fucking dudes that got themselves killed smoking pot.
In a hot box.
It would have been, you would have been martyred against the cause.
Luckily, we were listening to some cool Pink Floyd music at the time.
Oh, no. It's just,
No, that one wasn't that one. Anyways, we should move on here.
You don't say ham, you say spam.
Spam, spam, spam. Spam gram.
What do we got this week, buddy, in the mailbag?
I just did it.
Oh, that was it?
Oh, no, no. Oh, sorry. I got, see how distracted I got?
Deer in the headlights. I lost it. Deer in the headlights. As soon as you hear a jingle coming, you just fucking lock up.
No, it was our buddy Gitmo Yoho. And he said he had a greening out. Am I allowed to say that?
I don't know if he can. I didn't know what it was. I probably need a letter.
Oh, jeez. He said at age 37, it was one of the worst experiences of his life. But 2 weeks later, in a way, he's glad it happened. I'm especially glad it happened to me and not my sister-in-law. The strain was White Widow, by the way.
Damn.
You ever had that, White Widow?
Probably. I want some now. I want to see if I can green out.
Huh. And he said that Paddy Conklin is a riot, man. He's finishing it right now. He did hear me fight back a snicker at one point. I don't think I snickered at all during that episode.
Yeah, if you did, it was probably unrelated. I was probably doing something strange.
Yeah, it was probably fucking you, not Paddy.
I do try and get laughs at a grab in the studio sometimes.
Yeah, most of the time it doesn't work. He says if I have an MP3 of the healing ritual, he'll give it a try, but I'm not too sure what that is.
Oh, that was the Joey bit, I think. The bit with Joey. So it is in the podcast, isn't it? Yeah, it is. If you just listen to the whole little procedure, she goes over with producer Joey about his back. That pretty much is it. I think you could just like fill in whatever body part ails you.
That's a color work thing, I think, too, right?
Yeah, yeah. It was color something or other.
Yeah. So anyways, thanks, Yoho. I hope that was okay. I'm allowed to talk about that. I didn't really know what the hell it was. I didn't really realize you could actually... green out on weed.
Yeah.
Guess there's a lot of that going on in Oregon these days.
Oregon?
I mean, Oregon?
No, not
Colorado.
Oregon. Colorado.
Yeah.
Or Washington.
Yeah, or Washington.
Or Grimerica. So, yeah, I think, do we have anything else to get into? Of course.
Well, we got to mention the Paradigm 2014, right?
Oh, yeah, we do have to do that. Yeah, Paradigm Symposium 2014. By the time this comes out, it's only going to be about a month away.
Fuck, it's coming up quick, man. Holy cow, we got to book it. We got to book our stuff.
Yep, a lot of big names there.
Yeah, we're super excited.
There'll be a link in the show notes. There's a link on the website, too. That's, I think it's just paradigmsymposium.com. But check it out. The Grimericans will be there. I think the Graylians will be there. And holy fuck, Graham's knocking down the studio. Joey's wrecking shit with his fucking Dora headphones. Are you guys done? We finished this podcast.
I'm sweating. It's hot in here.
We've been in here for like 5 hours. This is the shit we do to you guys, do for you guys. So anyway, yeah, enjoy the double interviews. We'll be back refreshed next week after a week off. And hopefully with some good stories to tell.
Right on, buddy. Thanks.
All right, guys. Enjoy the chat. Thanks for listening. Okay, guys, in Grimerica tonight, we're going to be chatting with Alex Teplish. He's a graphic novelist. But first, how's it going, buddy? Nice shirt.
Hey, thanks, man. Yeah, I'm doing pretty good. I'd like to welcome the patient Alex Teplish into Grimerica tonight. He's the author of In the Beginning, The Epic of the Anunnaki. We've been trying to arrange this for months now, so we really want to thank Alex for his patience. And he's got this this cool graphic novel based on ancient astronaut theories, so it's something that we're familiar with here, and we're going to talk to Alex about his interest and his research and the genesis of his book. So welcome to Grimerica, Alex.
Thanks for having me, guys.
You're welcome. Like I said, thanks for your patience, man. It's great to have you on finally. So your book is addressing, it's pretty cool. It's talk about some stuff that, you know, we've talked about on here a little bit. The ancient alien show is actually what got Darren interested in a lot of this stuff. So let's start with your interest in this whole genre.
Right. So my interest goes way back to, I would say, my early childhood. I'm actually an immigrant with my parents and my family. We came over from the former USSR. I came to the United States when I was 2 years old, raised in Brooklyn, New York. And in my early years in elementary school, I went to a religious school where they taught us various stories from the book of Genesis and the Bible, the Old Testament. Those stories piqued an interest in me into what actually took place thousands of years ago. Where are these stories coming from? How have they survived over such a long time? How have people continued to follow these stories or really worship these stories for so many thousands of years? Mm-hmm. My family wasn't religious, and we weren't really observant of the religion, but I was educated on that subject. So that interest stayed with me throughout my life. Also looking into various other religions, various other ancient civilizations, and really being interested in across the board, trying to research that subject in general. In addition to that, I was always interested in science fiction and science as well in general. So that the combination of all that led me to continually be interested in extraterrestrial life, astronomy, ancient civilizations, and as an adult is when I really began to research, especially with the beginning of the internet, when I found out about all these various books on the subject, and that's when I began to order the books, read online articles, and so on. And this started about, I'd say, between 15 and 20 years ago.
Wow. So you must have been pretty excited when you see the ancient aliens show come on and it kind of just exploded in popular culture.
Yeah. I mean, I think that, I mean, my project started before the ancient aliens documentary series came out. But it was definitely something that helped propel this subject into mainstream culture.
Yeah, it's going to be a nice bit of wind in the sails. I wonder if they're coming out with the next season.
I believe there is a season right now, and that's
season
the newest
seven.
One.
Must be season seven. I know. Oh. I've seen up to the end of season six. I was on season six.
You were hardly a glimpse, a quick glimpse of Darren in the corner. Probably getting told to be quiet because he was causing a disruption in the panel discussion at the last conference we were at.
Still more than most people. I got my 2 seconds of fame.
So how did you reconcile the difference between what you heard and learned your religious upbringing compared to, like, you know, what you sort of realized could be other possibilities out there?
Well, my family never really taught me or, you know, my brother, we never really learned that, you know, we should believe the dogmas of religion or follow them wholeheartedly. These were something that we considered more of a tradition. And something that our culture and many other cultures have passed down, but at the same time, we weren't taught to basically just believe with faith and believe no matter what. And that's something I encourage anybody out there to basically use your own mind, research every subject that you're interested in. Don't just follow a group of people or a book or anything like that. Make your own, come to your own conclusions.
Do you take some of that to be a part of you being from Russia, or the formerly known, or USSR, like, kind of thing, a different culture, you know?
Definitely, definitely. I mean, in the USSR, my parents and many of their peers had to take special classes that were basically taught atheism and taught them that there's no such thing as God, and they're really, these religions are just stories. So that's something that I guess gave us a more of an open mind to kind of, and I'm not saying that all parts of religion are bad or there's any, you know, all I'm saying is that everybody should come to their own conclusions and use their religion or their belief structure to improve the world around us and not harm anyone around us, not judge others or say I'm wrong, I'm right, while everybody else is wrong. If you don't believe what I believe, then you're wrong. That's something that I'm completely against.
Yeah, well said. So what's your belief system at right now? Kind of like, what do you believe in something greater than atheism, for example?
Right. Well, putting religion aside and all the dogmas come along with it, I do believe in evolution. I do believe in science, and everything has a proof does exist out there for pretty much everything. Mm-hmm. I would say that in the grand scheme of things, with evolution and the universe, there's no limits to where evolution can take consciousness. And the idea of God is basically the ultimate level of consciousness. It's consciousness experiencing itself, creating within itself, and every aspect that we experience, including ourselves, are all part of this one grand consciousness. And even with saying that, I don't like to say that that's my belief and I'm right and everybody else is wrong. I always keep an open mind. Even with the ancient astronaut theory, it's not something that I can say I believe it 100% and that's the truth, and anything else that negates it is not the truth. I'm always researching the subject amongst many others, and I keep my mind open to any other contradicting ideas as well.
That's good. So do we. We like to be that way in Grimerica.
Mm-hmm.
So what as far as like your research goes recently, has your mind changed at all in the last little bit, or what are some of the things that you've kind of gone back and forth on as far as like ancient alien theory or ancient astronaut theory, I should say?
Right. Well, the one thing that, the one thing that's common, whether it's ancient astronauts or, an advanced civilization, is the theory that the Earth has gone through several cycles of destruction and what we'd say today in a reboot, with the last one being a great flood that affected most of mankind at the time. Both the ancient Sanskrit writings, which comes from India, and the Hopi Native Americans, which have thousands of miles between them, as well as thousands of years between the cultures, believe that we're in the fourth age and eventually entering a fifth age. Also, many civilizations, most ancient civilizations, not only the ones that stem from the three major religions, have stories and legends of a great flood all around the world. And they all trace back to sometime around the end of the last ice age. So that leads me to believe that there was definitely civilization on Earth prior to that. It may have been greater than what we know of today or what we thought existed back then. And many of the stories have been mixed up over the years and passed down as mythology.
Yeah, I would tend to agree with that. So would you say there was a modern type civilization, more modern?
Those are like the Vedas, aren't they, or something else? No, they're called something else.
The Vedas. The Vedas is from the ancient Sanskrit writings in India.
So,
yeah, I remember that. Like it goes into all that crazy shit. Like it all goes down to like this breathing turtle or something. It's like every breath of the turtle is a new. I remember when I think it was in Cremo's book.
The breathing turtle.
Oh yeah, it's like the whole. It's all a breakdown of the Sanskrit, like how I forget what it is, but all the different breaks down of the ages, and it's like every time this fucking turtle or whatever, and it's probably not a turtle, probably pretty offensive to some people. But anyway, whenever this thing breathes, it's like fucking some insane amount of time in our.
Oh okay. I see.
But every time it breezes, it starts a new cycle of this. And above that, there's these other fucking cycles that are going on. And above that, and like our cycle is fucking nothing. It's like at the top of the cog.
Right, right.
Yep. Yeah, I'm not sure. I'm not familiar with the turtle, but they definitely used a lot of metaphors and symbolic terms back then.
Do you have a favorite, or do you have a, what's your favorite, I suppose, site or piece of evidence, or what's one to you that seems pretty irrefutable?
It's hard to say. I can't say I have a favorite piece of evidence or a favorite site. Definitely not a favorite site. I mean, the information is mixed up all over the place. What I like to come back to is the Sumerian writings. The Sumerians were the first known civilization that resided in present day Iraq. They were the ones who created the wheel. They had advanced mathematics and astronomy. When there were no written, there was no written civilizations prior to them, at least no known written civilizations. They kept detailed accounting records of their day-by-day business and trade. And they claimed that much of their knowledge was handed down to them from the gods, the Anunnaki.
Huh. Can I ask you a very conspiratorial question?
Sure.
Do you think that our wars in Iraq right now have anything to do with Iraq being... you know, the genesis of our current modern civilization and the Sumerians?
Could turn out to be Turkey.
I think I think there's a lot of intertwined connections between what's going on in the world now and this ancient legend that it's traced back to. Starting with the confusion of the religions, the mixing up of cultures and languages that traces back to the Tower of Babel in the Book of Genesis. To all the artifacts that were found all over Iraq. The Nazis had a very high interest in researching those things in Iraq and collecting them.
Yeah.
In fact, and to this day, they say that there are over 40,000 untouched ancient ruins throughout Iraq, buried underground.
So, no way. That's crazy. Yep.
So there's still a lot to be learned and a lot to be discovered.
Ah, so, you know, you wonder about that, eh, Darren? Darren, if this has, like, got some true historical benefit to the powers that be, 40,000 underground sites still to be discovered.
Yeah. Fuck, I think didn't they just find another one in Turkey, too, that looks just like Göbekli Tepe?
Oh, I heard something about that, yeah.
Karahan Tepe or something like that. Exactly that, probably.
I don't know. I don't know. It is fascinating, though. It seems like stuff's moving so fast now. We're learning so much more than... I thought back the other day when I was at school, how different what we learned about history is compared to what we know now.
Right. I mean, back then, everything was basically... based out of books and the books you can get. There was no online ordering. There was no going, reading the books online or articles related to them. So I think the internet is really speeding up knowledge and spreading it around, yeah, as well as false knowledge.
Good and bad, yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah, I mean, even pictures and videos, right? Like, you know, even like 100 years ago,
you
could never see a video on something. Now you can see a video of anything you want in the world.
Facebook gets like 2 billion pictures a fucking month or something like that.
Yeah, I mean, that's crazy.
Maybe a day. I can't even remember. It was something fucking crazy, though. Have you seen Chris White's little movie?
No, I haven't.
Ancient Aliens Debunked?
Oh, yeah. I have seen that, and there have been other articles that came out about Ancient Aliens Debunked, and, you know, it's really... You know, I feel like if someone is looking to really debunk something, then they have... almost like their own agenda. And when you look deeper into some of these debunked articles or movies, there's a underlying religious agenda to kind of bring people back and say, find flaws with the theories and say, well, if I found all these flaws, then it must be made up and, you know, come back to our religion or what we've been professing all these years.
Yeah, well, I think he did turn out to be like a literalist. One of those literalists that, what's the word for it when everything in the Bible is like... actual, you know.
Right, exactly. So how can anyone with an open mind say that everything in the Bible is literal and should be taken literal?
The earth is 6,000 years old. Yeah, that's right. His shtick was the earth was actually 6,000 years
really?
Old. Yeah, or 10,000 or whatever they say it is.
Why did it get so much publicity if he's so dogmatic already then? I don't get that.
It was pretty good. It was pretty intriguing.
Yeah, I mean, the way I look at that kind of stuff is, you know, there are theorems in mathematics, like, for example, the Pythagorean theorem, mm-hmm. where you can easily prove it. You can prove it on paper. You can make a calculation and prove it to anyone. That's mathematical. Then there are theories which on ancient history, which are made up of many moving pieces and many discoveries that still are yet to be made and many that are already been made, right. Translations. So even if there are mistakes made, that doesn't negate the overall theory, and it really hasn't been disproven that that didn't happen, that something like that couldn't have happened. I don't like to say that I believe that theory 100%, but I believe that it's plausible and that more plausible than majority of the theories that have been presented.
No kidding. And when you think of all the, like what you address here too in your in your website and all that, is the amount of different civilizations that all believe in some sort of similar, you know, star people or some sort of intervention from the gods, which isn't just a spiritual thing, but a flesh and blood thing. It's pretty crazy. It's pretty, right. Well-rounded across, around the world.
Exactly. And having so many different cultures spread out by geography as well as time.
Yeah.
Talking about very similar things.
I like to look at it as a more of an ancient advanced civilization. Like, I wonder how many of these, you know, there's these tribes in like Brazil and other places in South America that they've like had zero contact with fucking modern world. They really don't know. Like, you see the specials on them where they're trying to keep the planes far enough away that they can't see them. And
right.
I wonder if they have pictures in their caves of fucking the crazy airplane they saw.
Well, there's something called the cargo cults.
Yeah.
In the Melanesian islands, and they formed at different times, but the largest and most popular one was formed during World War II, when that particular civilization was still living. Some people would call primitively, some people would call just closer to nature.
Yeah.
And they would see airplanes and actual American soldiers landing on their island, and they began to worship them, and they created a whole religion around it. They actually called it John From, because many of the soldiers' names were John, and they would introduce themselves as John From, you know, whatever state they were from.
Oh, and that's hilarious.
And they would actually build landing strips and replica airplanes out of their own natural materials in hopes that these soldiers would trade with them. And these soldiers would bring them on occasion various cargo that was very beneficial to their people. So they began to worship and created a whole religion around this whole thing. And that's kind of replicating of what our ancients may have done back then.
We're still doing it. I mean, we had an episode on the Raelians, right? And a lot of people would say the Raelians are doing just that. You know, they're worshiping some, you know, undefined, unknown alien presence.
Right. Yep. Know,
trying to build a landing pad for them to come and, I know, a whole embassy for them to come and safely land.
Yep. We have a landing pad here in Alberta.
I know. We still have to make a field trip up to that place.
So can you give us, can you give our listeners a little teaser about what the book's, the outline of the book and what they could expect there?
Sure. So my book was based on the nonfiction books of Zechariah Sitchin, who is a world-renowned ancient astronaut theorist. He actually studied the Sumerian language and came up with his own translations of the stories. Many of them do parallel with other translators who don't necessarily specify astronauts or aliens or any advanced civilization, but they do mention these stories and these gods. The theory is that the gods came to Earth from a planet, Nibiru, which is part of our solar system, but too distant for us to detect at the moment. And they came to Earth in search for gold. They began mining this gold, or at least a group of their own began mining the gold and working on this planet, and they rebelled. And these stories are part of the Sumerian writings. Huh. So I've basically taken the theories that Zechariah Sitchin, Eric Von Däniken, and many others have put together in their nonfiction books. Those books go into great detail. They read like textbooks. And I took the theory, I put it into a storyline. I took the characters, the gods, Enki, Anu, Enlil, many others, depict them in the book, And I also feature Zechariah Sitchin as a character, and that kind of introduces the story. He goes on a expedition through Kuwait to Iraq. They make a miraculous discovery there and begin translating. And that takes us 400,000 years into the past when the Anunnaki first embarked on their mission to Earth. And I also tie it to many of the stories from the book of Genesis, how man was created, the conflicts that existed, the Great Flood, the Tower of Babel, and a few others.
Wow.
So the Anunnaki are the Elohim.
Yep.
Oh, good one, Darren.
Thanks.
So is that's book one?
That is book one. Yeah, that's book one. I have ideas that I'm pursuing for eventual sequels, touching on other ancient civilizations and other translations. But for now, I'm working on this particular book, promotion of this book. And the ultimate goal is to have this story made into a movie or a series.
Nice, yeah. Yeah, well, I like the little trailer you have on your website. That's pretty cool.
Thanks.
Yeah. So is it, when you look at the 400,000 years ago.
How long's the trailer? Can we play it?
It's, yeah, you could probably play it in the...
It's only a mini 30 minute 31. Yeah, yeah. Should I play it right now?
Sure, if you want.
There's no narration in it. It's just music.
Yeah. Oh, yeah.
For listeners, they can. So anybody could see the trailer.
Like a nice sound.
Yeah, it's a good song. So anybody could see the trailer on the website inthebeginningthebook.com or by searching "In the Beginning: The Epic of the Anunnaki" on YouTube.
Yeah, that's cool. Yeah, I'm gonna link to all that in the show notes too, for sure. So when you go back 400,000 years, are the gods the technological type gods?
Yeah, so their technology was, I would say, advanced in certain areas. For example, genetics, because they were written about as having extremely long lifespans to the point where they were practically immortal. Right. Aside from chopping them up into pieces and not being able to revive somebody, they were able to basically cure all their diseases and live as long as they needed. And that is also written in the Sumerian texts. In fact, the Sumerians have something called the King's List, where they list all the kings that existed prior to the flood and after the flood.
Oh, man, I've heard about this King's List recently, like 3 or 4 times in the last couple of weeks, and I hadn't heard it really about it before that. So, yeah, I'm very, very intrigued. You should talk about that King's List. I can't believe it's coming up again.
Right. So in the King's List, they actually mention these gods in chronological order. They describe their lifespans, which were in the tens of thousands of years prior to the flood. That also aligns with the Vedic beliefs that the lifespans were much longer in a prior age. And they after the flood, they talk about after the flood, and the kings that existed then were the hybrids, or the demigods, or the mixture of humans and the gods. And that's when these gods handed down kingship and began to rule through the humans.
Huh. Now, is there an Egyptian King's List as well that goes way, way back, or is it the same one we're talking about here?
The Egyptian King's List starts much, much later. I'm not as familiar with their list, but
right, okay.
They definitely don't go that far back.
Huh. So this King's List goes way back.
Yeah, this King's List goes hundreds of thousands of years back.
Wow, fuck. I wonder if we're gonna find something that's really, you know, something that's non-refutable that goes back that far, right? Because it's just like our known history goes further back every month. It feels like people are discovering, you know, more and more things.
Oh, they find oopas, a couple oopas every year.
Yeah, I meant to ask Randall Carlson about oopas, out of place artifacts. We should do a show just on oopas.
Oopaloopas.
Yeah. So can we?
I got the King's List here. It's fucking crazy. They start out like ruling for 60,000 years, 30,000 years, 43,000 years. And then after the flood, they go down to like the ones you hear about in the Bible. Like, what's his name? Mufasa? No. Who was Noah's kid's name again?
I think that was from a cartoon, buddy.
Yeah.
That's the Lion King.
Noah's kid lived to be like 900 or something like that. And Noah supposedly lived to be six, or had kids at like 500 or something.
Enoch? Is that who you're thinking of?
Enoch is actually one of the characters in my book as well. And he was the the great grandfather of Noah. And he,
Methuselah, that's who it was.
Yeah, Methuselah was the, I believe it was the, he was the grandfather or the father of Noah.
Oh, okay.
And speaking of Enoch, there's a whole set of books called the Apocrypha, which are hidden or esoteric books that were banned or removed from the official canon of the biblical history. The early church leaders and synagogues decided that they didn't really align with the stories that they were telling. So they kind of banned these books and they removed them from their teachings. But these books still exist to this day. And even in the Dead Sea Scrolls, they're mirrored in those scrolls. And the Book of Enoch is the most curious one. I mean, they talk about him being taken up to the heavens, learning about the earth and the sun and the revolution and astronomy. And they even provided the number 365.25 days in the year. So there was a lot of knowledge that was taught in there that he was being taught by these, what they described as angels. And it just didn't make sense to the early church leaders, and they banned these books.
That's crazy, eh? Imagine that. It's almost like pointing right to it, eh? Like, okay, we're going to ban these books that actually explain more about. I don't know.
Fuck.
I don't know. One of these days it's going to blow up. And I still get sad when I think about all the history we've lost in, like, the Library of Alexandria and some of those. You know, oh, Darren's rolling his eyes.
In Library of Alexandria again, eh?
Well, one day when it does come out, I think it'll come out so fast that it'll be an overload of information for the humanity.
When do you think that's going to be? Do you see it as being soon? Something that's going to happen sooner than later?
I mean, I'm no prophet, but it seems like everything is accelerating, and things are happening faster and faster. The more you look at it, technology is escalating, increasing. Even conflicts are escalating. So I think that it's almost like the singularity. It'll all come together in one shot.
That's something else we talk about a lot. So speaking of conflicts, now if you don't want to answer this, that's fine. But you know, your home, you were from. What's currently known as Ukraine, right? That's where you were born?
Yeah, I was born in Ukraine, but the city that it's a complicated subject, because the city that I came from, Odessa, was most major cities in Ukraine at the time, and probably to this day still spoke Russian, even though it was part of Ukraine, and Ukrainian has a separate language, because USSR kind of dominated and imposed their language across the board. So in addition to that, I come from a Jewish background. So the Jews in Odessa and all over USSR were discriminated against, and for no apparent reason. They didn't dress differently. They weren't even religious. So it's not like they had some kind of real cultural differences besides their own hidden traditions.
Right.
So it was basically... the Nazis came in, the Romanian army that was supporting the Nazis came in during the Holocaust. And even prior to that, there were many pogroms where they would beat and kill Jews, and afterwards. So that discrimination never disappeared. And that's why many, many what we call Russian Jews left back then, back in the 70s, 80s and 90s, and came to America for a better life.
Huh. So what do you think about what's going on there now?
I think it's a very complicated subject. I think that within there's so many different factions and points of view. I think there's plenty of good people who want to see the best out of all the countries.
Right.
But then there are various factions that want to see their own agenda. There's many skinhead factions in Ukraine. Then there's the Russians that want to take over. Then there are those that don't. It's a complicated subject. And you know, I'm no political scientist to say that who's right or who's wrong.
Yeah.
And I guess I'm so far removed that, you know, for me, I'm an American. I was raised in America, and you know, although I was born there, and I like to research my roots.
Yeah.
At this point, I consider myself an American.
Yeah, it sounds kind of like us too, or at least like me, because these topics are so complex. I don't even know what to, you know, what to believe, what to hang my hat on. I just want to, you know, kind of take it all in and not really, you know, decide either way. It's tough. I don't know what to believe anymore.
Right.
Just believe me.
Believe what, you?
Just believe me. You can't go wrong.
So can you tell us any other bits of your book that people might want to know about?
Yeah, I at the end of the book, I do touch on some conspiracy theories, and I trace that back to the Tower of Babel story.
Okay.
Where in the book of Genesis, it's described as, let us go down and confound their languages. So in many cases, God speaks in plural, and instead of saying God, they write gods. When the Jews and Christians and Islam, they all teach that there's only one God. So it's kind of like, you know, from a spiritual point of view, there can only be one God. But from these writings, in many cases, it's almost like they forgot to take out the S or the pluralization of the word. They talk about the gods. And in the Tower of Babel story, they talk about humanity living under one culture and one language, and God or gods feeling that they humans weren't ready for that. And that's when they diversify the languages, spread people out, mix up the cultures. And I would say that if you look at most conspiracy theories, it all goes back to that moment when everybody was diversified and began fighting amongst themselves to kind of distract from what the truth was or what came before.
Wow. So when would that have been? Was that like in Egypt, sort of a few hundred years before Christ, or what kind of time frame does that land on?
This would be slightly after the flood, after the Great Flood.
Oh, okay. So going way back then.
Really. Way back, yeah.
Yeah,
way
okay,
back.
Okay.
Way back before any recorded history.
Oh, okay. Huh.
And there's other stories similar to that that are outside of the Old Testament from other cultures as well.
What about the evolution of us as humans and the different races that we are and the different maybe bloodlines or genealogy that we have? Like, where do you stand on that? Do you have any research or ideas on that?
Yeah, sure. So based on genetic studies, the early modern humans were all dark-skinned. What exactly their features were, that's something that's left to interpretation. But they were all dark-skinned, and the light-skinned features came out much later through both migration and mixing of other species. In fact, most recent studies show that majority of Europeans and Asians have mixed genetics from modern humans as well as Neanderthals and Denisovans. All Europeans have anywhere from 2 to 4% Neanderthal DNA. And I've actually submitted my own DNA to be studied, and I had like something like 2.6%, 2.4% Neanderthal DNA. And then many Asians from a certain part of the world have Denisovan DNA, which is another species that existed alongside the Neanderthals and the modern humans. So I believe that the races and the features that we see today are a result of the first modern humans spreading around the world, mixing with these other species, but as well as adapting to their environments.
Yeah.
Huh. It's a little bit of everything.
Yeah, that's interesting. Kind of makes sense to me too. I was just listening to this show the other day, and they talked about they've done this test about the Danish being the happiest people, and apparently there's something in their genetics that makes them more predisposed to contentment and happiness.
Is it?
That's interesting. Well, they say that people who have suffered trauma affects your DNA, and it gets passed down to your children.
Wow.
So that trauma is almost like an instinct being built, you know, the same way that most people would be frightened of a snake or a rat, because that instinct has been programmed over many generations. So if there was a group of people who lived isolated somewhere in the world and didn't necessarily face too much trauma, they may have happier genetics.
Wow.
And then you could, when we find them, we could sell that. I bet. Happy pills.
Yeah, finally.
Yeah, or I mean, imagine if they didn't really learn how to deal with that trauma. Like maybe some civilizations found a way to deal with their trauma better
mushrooms.
Than others, like the mushrooms, like the Buddhists that, you know, they kept trying to get you know, they're almost destroyed so many times, yet, you know, maybe they know how to deal with it.
Yeah.
So what else about the evolution there? So when you talk about the mixing of these, like, Denisovians and the
Neanderthals,
yeah. What? How far back are we going then with this? Because I keep asking these same questions, it feels like, but I can't wrap my head around how far back we're talking.
Yeah, it's such a long span of history that it's hard to pinpoint exactly. But the genetic studies show that this happened somewhere around 30,000 to 40,000 years ago. Most of the bones and most of the remains of the Denisovans and Neanderthals were found prior to that time, prior to 30,000 years. So anything after that, they haven't really found any of these types of bones or remains.
For like 70,000, or could be even somewhere between 70,000 and 500,000 years they were coexisting.
Right, exactly. And there are other species of humans similar to modern humans that existed at the time. There's another archaic human that they say most African people have in their DNA, which hasn't really been discovered, but they can just tell by the differences in the genetics. So we're all really a mixture at this point of various species, kind of like, if you take, you can like technically, yeah, like a mutt, you could take two different breeds of dog, or they've actually mixed lion and tigers in the past.
That's the fabled liger. I've heard about that.
Liger, exactly. And what happened was when they mixed the tiger and the lion, which wasn't natural, it was more of a scientific experiment, the offspring came out much larger than both parents. And that kind of traces back to the story of the giants throughout most of ancient history all over the world. They talk about giants living on this planet, living on the earth before and after the flood. And they were supposedly the offspring of the sons of God and the daughters of men. That's both in the Old Testament as well as many other stories. They talk about these hybrid beings.
Nephilim,
exactly.
Then they were almost wiped out, so they ran into the bush and evolved into Sasquatch.
And Yeti.
No. So Darren wants to ask you a question here.
Synchronicity question?
Yeah.
Have you, are you familiar with the term synchronicity?
Sure.
We have our synchronicities are kind of a big part of our show, I guess. We dedicate a segment to it from time to time. So we like to ask all our guests what synchronicity means to them, if they've experienced any, and sort of that sort of thing. So have you ever had any sort of synchronicities with any sort of, I don't know, maybe some sort of meaning behind them?
I look at all of life and everything that's taking place as a, you know, we see time as sequential, something that happens after another. But if you were able to kind of step out of this dimension and see time as another dimension, I would say that it's more like a jigsaw puzzle. So whatever happens in the future has to fit into whatever happened in the past, and vice versa. So I feel like everything is a synchronicity. It's just a matter of whether we recognize it, whether we figure out what it really means and what it leads to. Sometimes the smallest event can lead to a much larger event, as well as some major tragedies lead to good things, and vice versa. So I'm not sure if I could pick out a specific point of life that was a synchronicity for me. I'd say there's many.
That's a damn good answer, though. I like it. Yeah. I love the puzzle analogy.
Puzzle, just fucking take the linear time and smash it with a hammer.
Puzzle pieces.
Have you had any experiences of your own?
No, I can't say. I can't honestly say that I've had any extraterrestrial experiences.
No Sasquatch or anything like that.
No. I'm more from the research point of view.
Yeah, right. No, that's good. One day, we talk about. You know, we have a pretty open dialogue here about letting people share their shit if they've had shit happen to them.
Sure. I mean, I don't doubt that things have happened. I mean, there was a whole panel in there was a whole mock trial held recently in Congress with some congressmen. There are very well-known public figures that have come out that have basically said that there's definitely ancient astronaut and current aliens affecting the happenings on Earth. Examples are Paul Hellyer, the former Canadian defense official, who is similar to Donald Rumsfeld. Yeah, he's constantly coming out saying that we've had an ancient alien influence on this planet to this day. Dr. Edgar Mitchell from the Apollo 14 mission, an astronaut, famous astronaut, has said that we have had UFO encounters and aliens influencing the world. So there's definitely it's not just some people in rural areas that have seen this thing, but a lot of others, respectable people from all types of important roles in the government, military, and private sectors have come forward as well.
Yeah. Something else is just cracking open, just along with the rest of the accelerated timeline we're going through.
Yep.
Just the fucking code breaking down. The digital universe is starting to dissolve. It's running out of hard drive space. Someone's forgot about it on some laptop running in some laboratory.
Yep, exactly.
Well, before we wrap it up, do you want to tell some people the website, or if you're on the Twitter or the Facebook, or where these guys can track you down and find out more about you and what you're doing?
Yeah, sure. So the main website for the book is inthebeginningthebook.com. And on Facebook, it's facebook.com/inthebeginningthebook. On the Facebook page, I expand on the graphic novel. Aside from providing sneak peeks into the book, I also post various research articles, mainstream archaeology, astronomy that all relates to this subject on a regular basis, and engage the audience and constantly discuss these various subjects. And on Amazon, if you want to purchase from Amazon, you can search for In the Beginning, the book. Actually, In the Beginning, the Epic of the Anunnaki.
Yeah, that comes up on Amazon really quick. As soon as you hit it, In the Beginning, it pops up.
Perfect. Mm-hmm. And always use the Grimerica portal when you're ordering from Gramazon.
Gramazon, that's a Gramazon. Good. That's a good nickname.
You should patent that. Patent pending.
So yeah, we'll get people to go through the Grimerica portal and order Alex's book.
And then everybody gets a little bit of that corporate blood money.
That's right. Right on. Well, we want to thank you lots for coming on the show, Alex.
Thank you very much. Thanks for having me.
Yeah, and we'll link to all the stuff about your book, and keep in touch when you get the sequel out, and we'll have you back on.
Sounds great. I'd love to have you back.
Or when you get your movie made, of course, too.
That would be great.
Yeah.
Okay, guys, tonight in Grimerica, we're going to be talking with Emy Bitner about her webcomic, Trying Human. But first, the great Ground Unlock. How's it going tonight, buddy?
Yeah, I got the good G word. Thanks, buddy. I'm doing good.
I know, you've been bagging for a great lately, so
yeah, I know.
Throw you a bone.
Last time I got grimy, so. So, yeah, we've also got Red Pill Junkie here to help us out in this episode. Because Red Pill Junkie kind of introduced us to Emy, and I joined the Kickstarter. We want to talk to Emy about that too. So Emmy's the creator of a graphic novel or webcomic called Trying Human, and that follows the New York City Secretary Rose as she learns she's being abducted by a group of aliens, the Greys, a race without emotions or sentiment. She catches the interest of Hugh, an empathetic Grey, and his funny friend Quatsky, a reptoid alien from a neighboring mothership. Using a device, the trying human circuit, the two friends infiltrate Rose's life and a human world. So that's awesome. It's right along the lines of some of the stuff we've been talking about. So welcome to Grimerica, Emy.
Hi. Hello.
Yeah, it's nice. Thanks for joining us.
Yeah, this is cool. I'm nervous. I'm so nervous.
Oh, don't be. Super casual. So,
are you nervous too, Red?
No, I'm nervous. I'm excited, you know, because I've been a fan of Amy's artwork for several years by now, you know.
Oh, gosh.
I can't even remember when I discovered Trying Human, probably because someone recommended it. And, you know, I got in love with it. The first thing that caught my attention was, you know, when I first read it, was that, you know, it was very evident that the artist, you know, that means Amy, really did her homework, you know, with regards to studying all the aspects of the UFO lore and the alien abduction mythos. You know, you could plainly see even in the small, like, Easter egg, you know, small little details that maybe will go unnoticed by people who are not really that well versed in the literature, but for people who are, you know, that they could really perceive them from things like, you know, the color of the planes that are used to taxi all the personnel in Area 51, to even, you know, the fact that the main character Rose, you know, he's a redhead, so that kind of maybe implies a Gaelic ancestry. You know, all those little things, you know, really, really caught my attention.
Yeah, I love ufology and alien abductions. I've been into it since I was a little kid and have probably like 40, 50 plus books on the topic now, and I just love it. So I had to do a comic about it.
Sweet. So how long have you been working on the comic for?
I was trying to figure that out today. I think I was about 13 when I started it.
So wow. That would
be about, wow. I'm 27 now, so like 14 years ago when I started writing it. It's kind of like changed over the years, you know, because I was like young and stupid and, you know, whatever. But, you know, when I was in college, that's when it really kind of settled down to what it is now. So, yeah.
Yeah, the artwork's really, really cool. So you did you decided to do then a Kickstarter, right? Was that to move your comic from paper to web or something like that?
The other way around.
The other way around, right.
To paper, yeah. Yeah.
Right,
yeah.
Okay. Awesome.
Nobody goes paper to web anymore, Graham.
I know. I had it the right way, and then I flipped it around for some reason.
Yeah, yes. It's not like Amy is the New York Times, man.
So when is that going to be shipping out to people?
Gosh, I hope soon. I just, I'm doing an overseas printer this time, which I've never done before. So I just got done talking to my contact today, and they're shipping me the forms so that I can go through customs with my thousands of books and everything. I don't know where I'm going to put them all, but so yeah, soon, hopefully within the next month or two, they'll be shipping out. So yes.
You surpassed your goal, actually, by quite a bit.
Yeah, I forget by how much. A couple thousand. I mean, it's not like $1 million or anything, but it'll get me like at least 1,000 more books, so that's good.
Tell us about the Kickstarter experience a little bit.
It's not my first Kickstarter. I did one before for a horror novel, or like an art book. So I'm kind of used to it now. I don't know. I just sat back and let that sweet, sweet cash roll in. I don't know. I kind of already had enough of a fan base that I set my goal like really, really low. And so I was pretty sure I was going to make it. And I figured if I didn't, then I was just going to put it on a credit card and like go into debt. The books were coming whether other folks paid for them or not. So I wanted those books really bad.
Sweet. So you've been into ufology for a while. You got like 50 books. So can you tell us some of your favorite sort of genres of ufology or your favorite authors? Because it's obviously kind of a complex subject, and you can go down a number of different rabbit holes with it.
That's like the understatement of the century, right?
Yeah, yeah.
And it's so refreshing to have somebody ask me that, because usually I'm on like comic book podcasts and they're just like, there are aliens. And then like, that's the end of the conversation. So, but yeah, I love like the alien abduction side of everything. I just find it like really spooky and traumatizing and romantic. I don't know. I just love it. But Bud Hopkins, David M. Jacobs, John Mack, Barbara Lamb, those are like some of my favorite authors for the abduction stuff. So I actually just got to meet Bud Hopkins shortly before he passed away.
Sweet.
So, wow. Yeah, I was so sad. He signed my book and then he like died a month later. I was really upset. So poor Bud.
Do you know anybody that's had any sort of experiences, or have you ever seen anything you couldn't explain, UFO related or otherwise?
I've definitely had some sightings. I grew up in rural Pennsylvania, which I think is like the second state for most sightings. I think California might be first. So,
Definitely.
Yeah, and so I grew up in rural Pennsylvania, and I saw weird lights in the sky. You know, we had cows and stuff, and you'd see like lights over the trees and the woods and things like that. But my aunt saw a UFO over her farm growing up. And I used to ask her about it all the time. I was like, what did it look like? What did it look like? And I think after a while, she got sick of me asking. But so lots of people in the family had like weird experiences with lights and things like that. So, yeah, no, I've never seen an alien or anything, though. Just lights.
Has anybody...
As you remember.
Yeah, yeah.
I remember, yeah.
Has anybody surmised that maybe you're an abductee yourself?
Yeah, I've heard that a few times. I've never had anything suspicious happen to me, you know. I've never had like missing time or anything like that. So, just lights. I feel bad. I have like nothing more. Just here's my light.
No, that's
all I've got.
No, that's
that's all most of us have.
Yeah,
more than most of us have.
Yeah.
Graham's an abductee, I think.
No.
He's not letting on.
Not even close.
Darren is an hybrid, we're pretty sure.
Yeah.
A what? I'm a what?
Hybrid. You're a hybrid.
Hybrid.
Yeah.
Yes.
I like the sounds of that. I'll go with that.
yeah, he's a half Ojibwe, half white. So Emy, speaking of abductions and stuff, what do you think of the MyLab thing? Or what do you think of abductions in general? Like, do you have any sense of what you think is kind of going on?
I'm not, like, really hep to the idea of my labs. I kind of think it's, like my labs are traditionally, like, the military is abducting people and then making them think it's greys or something to that effect, right?
Yeah.
I actually think it's more like the opposite of that. I think it's more like aliens taking people and then they're seeing sort of military-esque propaganda or whatever, depending on what country they're in or, you know, their own personal experiences, like screen memories. I'm trying to think of the author who she was really informative on my labs, then she died of cancer.
Red will know it.
Yes, Kathleen Turner. That's right. Yeah, I have her CD, yeah. Voices of Taken. Yeah, so... I don't know like a ton about them, but I don't really have them in Trine Human. So
no, you don't have any Men in Black in there at all?
Well, I do have the Majestic. They don't like take anybody.
Yeah, so, yeah, right. So tell us about a little bit more about the novel and the theme of it, or what was it, the plot kind of?
So it's about Rose, and she's a human girl who's being abducted by the greys, and she kind of catches the eye of this one grey named Hugh, who kind of has like emotions, and he's like a lot different than the other greys because he's like really sweet and pathetic. And
his last name isn't Jazz, is it?
Hugh Jazz. Hey, took me a minute. You're a jerk. Anyway. all dead to me. I'm humiliated on my own podcast.
Oh, that's funny. Sorry.
If it helps, I've got grabbed way worse.
Oh, but so yeah, I'm trying to think where I was now. All I can think of is huge asses.
They make the world go round. The rockin' world.
Let me think. Yeah, there's multiple like plot lines going on. Rose has a boyfriend who is accepted into basically like the Men in Black. It's Majestic 12. It's a little different in my comic than what it quote unquote actually is. And then there's like the Reptoids, and they have their own little storyline going on. And trying to think if there was any other. Oh, and the, at the beginning of every chapter, there's a flashback to 1947 at the Nellis Air Force Base, or what would later become Area 51, that kind of recounts when this one gray alien named EDE-1 crash landed to Earth and kind of follows him around and stuff. So there's like four big plots sort of going on at the same time, and they're all going to come together at the end.
Yeah, particularly like that, that there is these two main like timelines in the story. Or, you know, the 1947 part, which you draw in all these grays and sepias, you know, like to give in a, like a vintage tone, and like the so-called modern timeline, you know, with Rose, you know. And I like how they are so intertwined in a like that maybe the events of the past have repercussions in the modern story, and maybe even vice versa, I don't know.
Yeah, there's definitely the two main girls, Rose in the present and then Phyllis in the past. They kind of can talk to each other across the timeline a little bit, and they're having these like really bizarre interactions with each other, trying to figure it all out, like all this, you know, craziness with the UFOs and aliens and all that good stuff. So, yeah, it's kind of weird now that I think about it, but it's just how I wrote it.
Oh, it sounds very cool. So how many books or chapters are there? Like, how does it actually work as far as, like, the series goes?
Every book is four chapters, and I'm on chapter 18, so this would be book five. Can I do math? Yes.
Four?
Four, yeah, I have to get my...
Oh, wait, no, how many chapters? Four in a book? Yeah. So it would be the fifth.
Yeah.
Yeah, so I'm on book five right now in the current storyline. Yes, I'm halfway through book five.
So do you do all the art yourself?
Yes, yeah, it's all me. Sadly, I'm all alone.
That's good.
Actually, RPJ did our art for our, he did our logo.
Oh, okay, yeah.
Because me and Graham cannot fucking draw at all.
Another thing that I admire about you, Emy, is that I noticed that when you're art style got a certain level of, I don't know, maturity, that you decided to update all your previous artwork so it would match your present style, you know? I mean, that I'm sure that was a hell of a ton of work, and I'm really, you know, kudos to you for doing that.
Yeah, after I got so far, I think, like, maybe around, like, chapter 12, 13, and I started to like go back and get ready to put the first book out, I was like, wow, this doesn't have nearly the emotional impact, the visual impact, like the storytelling just doesn't come across the way I want it to. So I decided to redo all the art from the first book, and I started redoing it. I'm not sure how many I did, like maybe 20 pages, and I was like, oh, I don't like these. And so I redid all those again. And then I finished the first book. So I kind of redid it like 1.5 times or something like that. But I'm actually working on getting the second book out right now. So, yep.
So go ahead, Red.
Yeah, just as long as you don't go all George Lucas on us, you know.
No.
It's Huey shooting first or something like that.
No. I haven't really like changed anything. Like I think I've added a teeny tiny bit of dialogue to help clear up some stuff, but overall it's the exact same story and drawings and everything, just a little better.
is it a pretty simple process going from, like, is it, can you just kind of print your art right off the, I guess you must have your masters anyway, right? How does the process work, I guess? Do you do outlines on paper and then scan them and
it's all digital. I actually just did like a little thing on my blog about how I do the pages, but yeah, it's all digital. The only thing I don't do on the computer is I tend to do like a lot of my scripting and sort of like my rough ideas. I get my like laying out all the pages together. I do that all like by hand just because it's quicker. But the final stuff, like the final art, is all done on the computer with a little tablet that's like a million years old now. So.
Yeah. And you just draw on the tablet and it kind of pops up in a program.
Yeah, it's like magic. I don't even do anything. It does it all for me.
Crazy. I didn't even know that was like a thing you could do. It's like fucking Etch-a-Sketch on steroids.
Yeah, that's kind of, I just put a link there in the little chat window. I guess I could put it over in this chat window too. But that's sort of like my process.
How much time does it take, you know, to go from the pre-planning of the layout to the final completion?
It's pretty fast. I can do like maybe about a page and a half a day or so, like a page and a quarter maybe, depending on how complicated the pages are and what's going on. Some of the scenes where there's like five or six characters like all sort of talking and interacting, those take so long. I just got done doing a long action sequence between my Majestic 12 and this reptoid fighting them, and they were like, it was jumping around and doing all this stuff, and I'm terrible at action scenes. It took like 4 weeks to get through or something. It was awful. Mm. I'm not good at action sequences.
Do you have to do a job on the side, or are you pretty much just concentrating on this?
Now I'm just doing this, but for a long time I was doing commissioned artwork. So I'm like a freelance illustrator. Well, now I'm a webcomic artist, I guess, but I was a freelance illustrator. So I would do whatever art kind of rolled my way. You know, I did like some book covers and I contributed to some like little art anthologies or did t-shirts, you know, whatever. And then lately, I haven't taken any commissioned work. I'm just too busy with trying humans. So,
you also did a short story in comic book comic format based on this famous case of the disappearance of Frederick Valentich. Is it not?
Yeah, I did that for an unsolved mysteries. What would you call it? Anthology. I just used that word and I couldn't even think of it. Yeah, so I can actually put that link up if you guys want to see that.
Yeah, sure.
I put it all online because I'm a cheap.
We have our friend Micah Hanks, who, you know, I think he's kind of obsessed with that particular case.
Yeah, it's really interesting. You know, when I was asked to participate, I kind of forgot about. I was like, oh, they wanted to do missing people, and I was like, well, I have to do a missing person related to a UFO case. Yes, that's me. I just have to. So I went and found him, and I was like, oh my god, I totally forgot about that case. I saw it on like Unsolved Mysteries and Sightings, like way back when I was a youngin, and it's just such a creepy cool story there, but I put the link in the chat there, so if you want to see that. It's only 6 pages. It had to be really short for the book, but
yeah. I actually didn't you listen to the episode where I solved the Valentich case, Red?
Oh, so you say, man.
Going in the book. Well, the black and white adds a cool effect to it.
Yeah, I think it looks pretty snazzy. I don't do black and white often.
Oh man, your art is awesome. Have you always had that, like, it's a natural talent? Did you, like, I just can't even comprehend being able to do that. Actually, I've just got zero drawing skills.
Well, I always wanted to be an animator and work for Disney.
Right.
Work for the Rat. And I went to college for animation, and about 2 years in, I was like, wow, I really don't want to animate. I want to be a storyteller. And I knew that if I went into animation, I would kind of always be under somebody else's heel, you know, for what I was going to be drawing. And I was like, I just want to draw aliens and UFOs and reptoid penises. I don't want to be doing this. So I graduated college and I moved to California, and I was really close to kind of getting my foot in the door at Disney. And like last minute, I was just like, I can't do this. I just know I wouldn't be happy, you know? Wow. So I kind of made this executive decision to go off and do my own thing. So, yeah.
Do you still go ahead. Sorry.
Oh, I was just going to say, I am trained as an artist. I didn't just like crawl out of my mother's womb. I'm proficient at art.
It must have come pretty natural though to you.
It's a lot of hard work. I don't think I'm really that great of an artist. Oh my God. I
you gave up the corporate blood money.
Yeah, I kind of regret it every now and then, like when times get tight and tough. But I can't do it. I'd be so depressed.
Well, you've inspired other people to do their own webcomic. We have Dennis Lernedy, Science Guy Toy Jr. in the chat room, and he's a fan. He's doing his own webcomic now. That's pretty cool.
It's hard. It's really hard.
Yeah, that's why we just podcast. It's actually fairly easy. Well, editing is kind of a bitch, but for the most part, we just get on here and yap, and people seem to listen. We got RPJ to do our pictures for us.
Too bad it costs us money to do it.
Yeah, don't tell me about it, because I received a commission from another Grimerican, and I don't know how am I going to find the time to
actually pick up. Yeah, we need some t-shirt designs, Red.
So, Emy, about trying human, do you have a very definite notion of where the story is going to end up?
Yes. If I didn't, I'd be like a nervous wreck and in tears. I'd be like, what am I doing? Yeah, I leave it kind of loosey-goosey, like so that I can kind of slide scenes around a little bit, or like a lot of scenes don't have completed dialogue. I kind of want to wait till I sort of get there to figure out what characters are going to say to each other. But overall, yeah, it's pretty much set in stone. There's not a whole lot that's going to be changing from here to the end.
Really? And so have you known that from day one?
Yeah, at least the big plot points. Like, there was a big scene recently where Rose lost her memory for like the millionth time of the Greys, and there was like this big emotional scene where she had to like leave, and Hugh was all sad about it and stuff. Like, that scene's been in there for like 8 years or something now, and I just got to it like 4 months ago. So yeah, it's kind of weird that I've written all this way, way ahead of time, that it almost seems boring to me.
When you get there?
Yeah, it almost seems like formulaic and everything, and I'm just sort of like cranking out the pages, and then, you know, I'll get to these scenes and everybody's like, oh, you know, and all upset and whatever. And poor little Grays. So, I don't know. Whatever.
What about your viewpoints about this whole thing, you know, the abduction phenomenon? You started so young. Maybe it's obvious that you... that the story is set in a very what we call the ETH, you know, the extraterrestrial hypothesis, as a way to explain away the both the UFO phenomenon and the abduction.
Yeah.
Have your viewpoints about those two changed as well?
No.
Over the years? Okay.
I'm so stuck on Greys and reptoids. I want it to be real so bad. I'm pathetic. I'm sorry. I was kind of like raised with like the 80s into like the early 90s ufology movement, you know? So that's kind of like where my mind is. But I'm totally open to anything that, you know, comes my way. But oh, please let the Greys be real. I want it to be real so bad. So...
Well, you know, it's kind of understandable though. Like when you really look at the phenomena, it's kind of easier to. I kind of argue that Occam's Razor kind of says that, hey, that there are ETs visiting us. That with all the strange shit that's going on, like, there's some of the other explanations seem farther fetched.
Yeah, but there's also people like Jacques Vallée who says that, that if it all comes down to, you know, space people come of coming from other planets, that he will be very disappointed, you know, because of all the high strangeness, you know, involved in the phenomenon.
Yeah. I mean, personally, I think that it's a multitude of answers. Just about probably anything we can imagine is partially responsible for some of the phenomena.
Yeah, but the grays, for example, it could come from another planet. I think it's more likely that maybe they come, if you want to see it in that respect, that they come from another dimension, you know, something like that.
Right.
Interdimensional.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Not intergalactical?
You're not going to rap, are you?
Oh, you see, I was waiting to see if anyone was going to pick up on that.
But also, there's other aspects in the storyline that seem to be far more metaphysical than some standard ufologists will dare to take it. You know, all this mystery surrounding the wrath and all that we
that's one of the things I worry about, is because I don't know. My fans are not really there, I guess, for the ufology stuff. But I always worry that some ufologist near the end is going to be like, that's too out there. That it's part of ufology, that little thing at the end there. But it is pretty, I can't give it away because it's a big spoiler. But it's a lot more, metaphysical is a good word. It's not as like tangible as like a spaceship or, you know, an alien, I guess, if that makes any sense.
Dimethyltryptamine.
No.
That sounds fun anyway, though. What was I going to say? You go.
I go. Huh. So, well, what about the future after this thing? After, like, how close are you to completion?
I'm over halfway now. So, I think, what was it? Chapter 16. Wait. Yeah, 16 was halfway, and I'm like over halfway now. And I'm putting out faster and faster every day. So probably in the next 3 years, it'll be finished.
Are you leaving the future open?
Yeah, I'd like to kind of do a sequel. I want to do something about the Dulce or Dulce, however you pronounce it. Base.
Dulce.
Is that it? I've heard it like three different.
That's Canadian accent. Okay. That's how does Mexico go?
Dulce, like in candy.
Yeah, see, that's what I thought. Dulce, yeah.
Dulce and candy.
No, dulce.
Dulce? Dulce?
Yeah, dulce.
How does that sound like candy?
That's what it means in Spanish, man.
Oh. Dulce is candy
in Spanish.
Well, I don't know Spanish. I'm a Canadian.
So, yeah, I'd like to do something about that base. Because right now it's all about like Area 51 and stuff.
Is this an adult novel?
It's like PG-13. There's like boobs and sex. So.
Oh, there is, eh? Okay.
When I was a kid, that was R.
Is there?
Yeah. Nowadays, that's like PG.
Well, I don't like. I guess I don't show them like bumping and grinding or anything. I just like.
Is there interspecies? Contacts?
Yeah. Ooh, yeah.
Captain Kirk. Oh my gosh, yeah. That's like.
Yeah, there's some reptoid Yowie in there.
Wow.
Reptoid Yowie. Oh, thank you. Bless your heart. Huh. Yeah, there's gay stuff.
Oh, very cool. I can't wait to get mine in the mail. Hopefully that should be soon.
God, please let it be soon. I'm getting so tired of waiting on these books.
You're probably getting hassled too, I'd imagine.
Oh, it is. I originally was like, oh, it's only going to be like 2 months, because I was going to go with a printer that I had used before. But then this foreign printer was like, we can give you like 2,000 extra books. And I was like, okay. So I went with them, but it's a lot longer of a wait time. So, oh, well, now I know. Knowing's half the battle.
And what about collaborating with other artists, you know, to expand, you know, the trying human universe?
Yeah, I'd be up for that if there was anybody who wanted to. I don't think I'm that big yet, but that'd be cool. Like Batman.
Yeah, you never know.
You have a lot of fan art, you know, in your website, in your forum, and I'm sure that, you know, after the story is completed, you know, there will be even more.
Yeah, I hope. It's kind of cool to see, like, everybody making their own, like, grays and reptoids and stuff. Though every now and then I get emails from people and they're like, did you know this is a real thing? Like, there really are grays? And they'll, like, send me the links to, like, Wikipedia and stuff. And I'm like, no. I thought I came up with it.
They're tulpas.
Have you been contacted by people claiming to have had the abduction experience?
Yes, and I've had people contact me who say they've met Hugh, and I've had people contact me who say they are reptoids. I've had just about every sort of person under the sun contact
me. Said they've met the character from your book?
Mr. Jazz.
Yeah.
You guys. So what is their reaction? Do they like it? Do they don't like it?
They seem like they like it. I've had a few people who kind of side with like the majestic sort of things, or they really hate grays, or they hate reptoids, and they kind of are uncomfortable with what I'm doing. They think I'm sort of beckoning them, or, you know, I shouldn't be writing it, that kind of stuff. Or I had somebody accuse me of like being part of some conspiracy.
Oh yeah.
Disinfo.
Yeah.
Yeah, like, yeah, doing like misinformation kind of stuff. And I'm like, no, I'm not. I'm sorry.
Oh, you should look into it. It's good money.
No.
That's what we do here.
I did have one girl who claimed she was an abductee. And I said, well, how do my grays, the way I draw them, fare up against, you know, what you've seen? And she says, oh, they're really, really close, except they have like slightly more wrinkles around the eyes or something to that effect. So I'm close in the way that I draw them. So I'm pleased with that.
You should go to a couple of UFO conferences and sell those suckers. That'd be good.
I've thought about it.
We'll share a table with you or something.
Oh, that'd be fun. I'm usually a fixture at MUFON.
Oh, sweet.
Yeah, I go to like almost every single one. They went to Florida recently, and I couldn't go to Florida. But when they're out this way near California, I go. So
go to the International UFO Conference in Arizona in February?
Yeah, in Scottsdale, just near Scottsdale. Yeah, it's awesome.
Yeah. Yeah, I should totally do that one, actually.
Yeah.
Now that I have some money.
Yeah.
I thought it was like, I thought to California people, like Arizona's like, eh.
No, I don't think so.
Was it saying like I'd rather be dead in California than alive in Phoenix or something like that? Where did I hear that?
I don't know.
It's a song.
I don't know.
No?
You've been listening to many podcasts.
That's
an
email.
You've been listening to many California podcasts.
A couple of emails from Phoenix now.
Yeah. So are you still doing freelance work at all?
On and off. Why? Are you interested?
Possibly.
Yeah, I can do it if you'd like it. It's no big deal. Mm-hmm. I kind of pick and choose, though.
And is most of your artwork cartoonish like that, or do you do all kinds of stuff?
I can do all kinds of stuff.
Yeah.
I usually get the kind of cartoonish stuff, like that's what people kind of want for me because of Trying Human or whatever, but I can do like gritty stuff or horror art or whatever you need. So
yeah, I don't want the horror stuff.
Oh no.
So do you do zombie stuff too? I mean, what about the zombie thing? That's taken off these days.
Yeah, I like Walking Dead. I watch like a lot of pretty gruesome movies all day while I work, so like slasher movies and things. I should probably draw more of it. I don't really, though. Most of my time is taken up by Trying Human and aliens.
I draw a lot, actually. I fill up usually a couple pages an episode with wiggly lines.
Yeah,
it's drawing. No, this is art to somebody.
That's an alien transmission, man.
This is automatic writing, Graham.
I'm actually drawing right now how to put them up when I'm done.
I'll put mine up, too.
Do you ever feel like you're channeling at all? Like you're in the zone and you're just sort of in the moment. Do you ever feel like it's just happening?
Oh, yeah. excuse me. Yeah, once I get started, I really don't like to stop. And I've kind of gone on binges where I've drawn for like almost 20 hours and stuff. I really shouldn't do that. It's like not good for me, but yeah. Once you're kind of in this. Oh, sorry. Go ahead.
When the mothership says to do it, though, it's kind of hard to resist.
Yeah, I have to. I have to.
Well, that's a common theme, you know, about people who claim to have the abduction experience. You know, they feel that they are compelled to tell their story, you know, to promote the message that the aliens have given to them. You know, they have a sense of a mission that they have to fulfill.
Yeah, I like to sit at the table and carve aliens out of mashed potatoes. This means something. I'm going to the mountain. Okay, no, it's not that bad.
Scientology.
Did anybody get that reference? I feel so alone.
Yeah, I did, yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, we've got it up. We've got
like, oh my God, please tell me you've seen that movie.
We've got it up on the wall here.
No, okay, no, good. That's about one of my favorite movies ever, you know.
Oh, yeah, it's the best.
I saw it when I was like 3 or 4, and I don't even remember.
Yeah.
That explains a lot, actually.
Doesn't it?
I saw it when I was like 6, and I remember I went to bed that night, and I just kept saying to Mom, going, it's not real, right? That's not going to happen, right? I was so scared. I was like, they're coming for me. I've always been terrified of the Greys.
And now you look back on that movie, and it's like so tame.
Yeah, it's really tame. Yeah. Oh, well.
Why are you laughing?
Well, I'm just reading your comment in the chat room about saving the Library of Alexandria.
You're copying me. That's what I said last time.
What?
Yeah.
That could be a synchronicity right there. Oh, we forgot to...
That's not synchronicity. There's another word for that.
Plagiarism?
Plagiarism.
Oh. Did you really say that?
Yeah, but maybe not in the Grimerica show.
No, wow, man. I didn't know that. Huh.
So what about animation, Emy? You would like to, you know, maybe try to do some shorts, you know, animating the characters?
Oh, my God, not me. I've got too much to do. But if anybody ever wants to pick it up for a miniseries, feel free. Like,
you know, I know why you say that, because, well, one of my first jobs was trying to become an animator, you know, and it is a lot of hard work. You're doing it the traditional style, but now with things like motion capture and all that, you know, and even you can even rig like the kinetic sensor of your Xbox, you know, and you can use it like to do it like some kind of DAY motion capture system, you know. Maybe that could
do. Yeah, somebody else is gonna have to cheaper. Do it.
You know, well, I'm just giving some ideas, so maybe, you know, some fan will
get it ready for the Oculus.
Exactly. You know, trying human for the virtual reality experience.
Get your own new groin. I'm totally open to other people like doing work like about it or whatever. Just don't steal my shit. I'll come after you with all my lawyers. All none of them.
We don't have any either. Did you... it seems crazy that you've had it. Like, does the story change at all? Or, I mean, is it like you've got it like a loose outline and you just kind of, you know where it's going, but you don't quite know how you're getting there?
No, it's all pretty much written down. I mean, is that okay? I feel bad. It's not.
No, that's just.
Darren can't wrap his head around it. That's all.
I can't even plan what I'm doing tomorrow.
I mean, like, I've had characters that kind of, like, people seem to, like, react to, like, oh, I really want to know more about this character, and I'll kind of think of a better way to, like, get them into scenes, and that kind of links me up to some other stuff, gets me some shortcuts or whatever, but as far as the main characters go, I mean, their story's, like, yeah, it's pretty blocked out, it's pretty set in stone, yeah. Mm.
And how old were you when you came up with the entire storyline?
I started it when I was 13, and then it had like about
abduction written all over it.
Yeah,
13. It's a very significant
oh
yeah.
In the paranormal, you know.
Whoa, well, is it?
Yes.
Yeah.
It's when the poltergeist start to manifest, when people start to have visions. You know, I think Joan of Arc, when, you know, start when she saw God and all of that shit.
Are you going to burn me at the stake?
No,
Graham's not that old.
Yeah, not if you don't wear a coat of armor.
Oh, yeah, I've always been terrified of grays, though, since I was about like 4 or 5 years old. And when I was 13, I kind of made up my mind, like, nope, I'm not going to be scared of this anymore. I'm going to draw aliens, and that will make me get over it. But I couldn't bring myself to actually draw a gray, so I made all the aliens like hybrids, like the like when they have their circuits on in the comic, that's what they used to look like all the time. Like they just were kind of these pale humanoids. And it wasn't until like I was about 17 that I drew a gray for the first time. I was like just so petrified of them. So now they're like old.
Like a way to exorcise your demons.
Yeah, yeah, definitely.
Very interesting.
And it wasn't until about like 3 years into the comic, like putting it online, so like about 2010-ish, that I started to really get over it. Like I could sleep with my head above the covers and I could walk around at night and not be scared and stuff. But it's like, I feel like such a child saying this. Like I was so scared. I was so scared. But I can totally relate.
The first time I read Whitley Strieber's Communion, I was already in high school and I had to sleep with my night lamp on for the next 6 months, you know, and everybody would laugh at me. My sisters would mock me and say, you're a big man. How is possible that you are scared by that one little book? I had to turn the book, you know, the cover, you know,
yeah,
put it upside down. I couldn't stand watching it.
I still have to do that. In fact, I just got a second copy of Communion that I'm going to do a giveaway on. And I had it sitting on my desk for like 2 weeks. And I was like, all right, I got to flip you over. You're freaking me out now. So I have it turned upside down and in the back of my shelf until I can.
It seems like it's an abnormal fear in a way you guys have about the graves. Like, I wonder if there's something there that just triggers something a little more than it should.
Well, I'm not going to deny that I haven't wondered about it, you know, but...
We're taking you for a hypnotic regression and mini, buddy.
You know, I think that will be a terrible idea because I have read so many abduction books by now that I wouldn't trust anything that will come out of an hypnotic regression.
I actually, can I tell this story? Is this going to be
weird?
Yeah,
please.
This is the first time I've ever talked about this with anybody but one person.
In Grimerica, perfect.
Yeah, I thought, well, what the heck? Barbara Lamb, do you know who Barbara Lamb is?
Yeah.
Yeah. I was like, well, what the heck? She lives out here and I'm now in California. I should go do a hypnotic regression with her. And so I contacted her and did the whole shebang. And I told her right away, I said, I know everything about UFOs and aliens, so I can't be sure that what I'm going to say while I'm under is going to be a unique experience to me. It could just be like a quilting of everything I've read, you know, just like a patchwork of Betty of Barney Hill and Bud Hopkins and, you know, whatever. And I did kind of talk about some stuff about my old house, the farmhouse where I grew up and stuff, but I can't be sure if any of it was, you know, real or not. But it was interesting. She was really nice and it was fun. So we...
Well, something similar to that has happened to a friend of mine. I don't know if you have heard of him, Mike Cleland. He has this blog called Hidden Experience.
I think I've heard of it.
You know, he's been researching a lot about abductions and how the UFO phenomenon is somehow related to owls.
Oh, yeah.
So anyway, he went to England to give a lecture, and after that, he had this like past life regression, you know, and he wrote about it recently in his blog. I might send you the link via email after we finish here. But anyway, so he was there in the regression, and he was, you know, going through this like scenario, you know, in which he was like living in another life, you know, in I think it was Ireland or Scotland or something like that. Barely anything about UFOs came out of it, but to him it was incredibly therapeutic, you know. It helped him a lot because he suffered from depression and all that. And, you know, by the end of it, he came to the conclusion, you know, okay, so maybe this is something that my subconscious made up, you know, it's completely fictitious, or it may be a true, you know, past life regression, but I'm not going to worry about, you know, whether it's real or not. I'm going to accept it as it is and ride with it, you know, because he remembers something that John Mack went through when he was investigating. He was talking to a shaman in an Amazonian tribe, you know, and the shaman was disclosing to him, you know, some of the lore of his tribe, some of their legends about, you know, people who came out of like metal ships that landed on the jungle and all that. And whenever John Mack would keep interrupting the shaman and say, is this what really happened? Was this literal truth, or is this like metaphorical truth, you know? And the shaman would roll his eyes and say, you know, among my people, there is no difference. And that, you know, seems like a very wise attitude to take with this kind of subject.
Yeah, I you know, I definitely didn't know what to think of it, but after I did that, I kind of got over the whole fear of the grays thing, and I kind of never looked back. I never was scared again, and I was like, all right, whatever that was, that's what it was, and I let it be and just kept working on my comics. So
it worked.
Yeah, I think it worked, you know. And she was a real sweetheart. She like wrote me letters and stuff. So I guess I was more enamored by her. I was like, oh, Barbara Lamb, sparkly eyes, you know. I'm always excited when I get to meet ufology people and everything. I've met a lot of them now.
Is there anything other than ufology? Like, are you into Bigfoot or?
My dad's into Bigfoot. He's really into that kind of stuff. He's always like, oh, have you heard anything about Sasquatch in California? I'm like, no, Dad. I was more into crypto stuff as a teenager. I've kind of gotten out of it, but I'm still interested. Like, I'll watch the shows or documentaries or whatever kind of comes my way. So,
well, you mentioned that you grew up in Pennsylvania, right? In Pennsylvania, and there's this UFO researcher, Stan Gordon, you know, who
wrote
a lot about this very active UFO wave that happened in Pennsylvania in 1973, which is, by the way, the year I was born. And there were a lot of very crazy UFO sightings mixed with Bigfoot sightings over that area.
Yeah, I remember that. Well, I mean, I wasn't there, but I remember hearing about it. Was that in the Appalachia area? Do you remember?
I'm not quite sure, but maybe.
Maybe. I grew up on the west side of the Appalachian Mountains. Very, very close to that area. Very woodsy.
Very interesting.
I would have been scared to run into
thickens.
A Bigfoot.
Yeah. So speaking about Mike Cleland and his stuff, Darren always asks our guests. He's got a new thing he wants to ask everybody.
Oh, yeah, about synchronicities. You know what synchronicities are?
I can kind of guess from Lord, like it's something that sort of lines up together. What it is? Explain it, and I'll.
Well, I don't really know.
The shortest definition is that it is a meaningful coincidence.
Meaningful coincidence.
So we do a little segment on our show, kind of about people send them in, and I rate them fairly harshly. But we like to ask our guests anyway if they give them any credence, if they've experienced any of them on their journey, and if they've kind of meant anything to them.
Okay. So what? What do I do?
So have you ever had any weird coincidences or anything like that along your path?
Maybe something related to trying human. Like you were researching some book and all of a sudden, you know, you find that book, you know, in your library, you know, without even looking for it or something like that.
Weird synchronicities. So, like...
The fact that neither of you can look at the communion cover is kind of one.
No, no. Well, if you want to see it that way.
Okay, well, I got a teeny tiny one, though this isn't really fair, but I was, like, watching this really obscure alien abduction show, and they were, like, just, like, interviewing random people about their abductions and stuff. And I mean, like, each person they only interview for, like, a minute and a half or something. And then, like, a couple days later, I went to a MUFON meeting in Studio City, California, and at the end of the conference, we all got up and got in line to buy books and look at all the, you know, merchandise that was out on the tables. And there was a lady in front of me, and she kind of like mentioned something to somebody real quick, and I heard her voice, and I tapped her on the shoulder. I said, "I'm sorry, I don't mean to be rude, but you seem so familiar to me, and I just can't put my finger on it." And she goes, "No, you don't know me." And she turned around, and I let it be for a minute, and I said, no, I think I know you. Have you been on TV or radio or something?" And she goes, "Well, I was on this abduction show, you know, a few years ago, but it didn't do very well, and nobody knows about it." And I was like, "I saw it. I saw the show."
That's you know. A synchronicity.
Yeah, yeah, there you go, yeah.
Yeah, it was just a few days before I went to that meeting, and I was like, "I know you." Yeah, the show only aired one time, like on the Lifetime Network, like years ago, and it got leaked onto YouTube, and I saw it, and it was like 30 minutes or something. And so there you go. There's my little coincidence. That's,
yeah, closer to precog.
Oh.
That's ripple before the stick shit. But I'll still give it a 6. 0.5.
That's not bad for your first time.
No, if it was grabbing, be like a 4.
Well, if I would have known, I would have made up a better one.
Oh, then it wouldn't count at all. Darren can see right to the lies.
He could sniff them out.
Yeah.
If I'm not sure, I just assume.
Yeah, I don't have any good coincidence stories. I always set them all up. Like, when I went to Comic-Con a few years ago, I knew Whitley Strieber was going to be there. So I took all my Strieber books and I was like, "Funny bumping into you here. Why don't you sign my communion book?" He did not want to sign my book. He didn't like that at all.
Eric von Daniken didn't want to sign my book either.
Yeah, his wife was really nice. I was like, "Oh, you're a doll. Make your husband sign my book." So, oh, well.
Weird.
I think he's trying to get out of the hole. UFO thing, alien thing. I don't think he wants to be known
with
for that.
Well,
I don't know. He still does his podcast, though. So
I guess. He just seemed really, like, uncomfortable. I don't know.
I think that's his general demeanor when he's involved. Because he doesn't know when someone is going to go with the anal probe crack.
Oh, yeah. No, I never would have.
I know, but the guy, yeah, the guy, he's kind of like, you know, scarred for life because of that.
You know, I've never actually looked at the signature. I hope it doesn't say, "Fuck you, don't talk to me anymore, have a crappy Comic-Con, love Streamer." It better not.
I'm gonna check.
I doubt it.
You didn't even read it.
No, I was just like, "Thank you." And they walked away and he was really angry. And I was like, "Okay."
Really?
Well, he seemed irritated.
He didn't expect to see so many UFO people at a Comic-Con, maybe.
Well, it was just me. I was the only one.
Did everyone know he was coming? Maybe it wasn't.
Yeah, what was he doing there anyway? Was he promoting?
He worked on a comic book as a script writer or something.
They were making it
into like a show or a movie. I'm not sure what. But at the end, everybody was like talking to him about that. And then they all left. And I came up clutching communion and like just shoved it. I was like, "Sign my book."
Oh, yeah. He was probably thinking, "Yes, I'm going to go to this conference. Nobody's going to ask me any fucked up shit about aliens. It's good." And then bam.
Well, I actually went up to his wife first and I said to Anne, I said, "Do you think he'd sign my book?" And she was like, "Oh, he'd love to." And so she went and got him for me. And I was like, "Oh, God." He already looked mad before he came over. And I was like, "Please don't hurt me. I just want you to sign my little alien book and I'll be gone." So.
But, and that's the one you're giving away?
No, that's not what you mean. I have a blank copy that you can go to Comic-Con and get him to sign it for you if you want.
I don't know. It sounds kind of hostile.
I've got a bunch of my other books signed, so they were all real nice, like Bud Hopkins and David M. Jacobs and stuff. So,
Very cool. It's so cool to talk to somebody else about UFOs. I love it.
Yeah, no, I love that stuff. It's great. I love it all.
So is there anything else you want to tell everybody before we start wrapping her up?
Nope.
No, that's all it. Well, we're going to link to all that stuff in the show notes. And obviously, people will be able to buy the book at some point.
Yes, and it will be on my website, trainhuman.com. I'll have a big ad for it and everything. So
sweet.
Yes, the website is tryinghuman.com and the comics Trying Human, so everyone should check that out. We'll make sure we link to that in the show notes as well. And let us know when the books go on sale, and we'll make sure we tweet it out and throw something on the site.
Definitely. I'll be screaming it from the rooftops.
On the tweeter.
Red Pill Junkie, do you got anything else?
Well, no, nothing else. You know, it's been a great honor, you know, having the chance to talk to Amy, you know, last hour, chat to all you who were following us through the chat room, especially to Susan and to Holly, who is right now playing with that big ball of string in the sky.
Hey, Red, can you just repeat that? We had a little a glitch. Yeah.
Only, well, a big shout out to the people in the chat room, especially to Susan and to Holly, who is right now playing with that big ball of string in the sky.
Alrighty. Are you still there, Emy?
Yes.
Thank you so much for coming on the show.
Yeah, no problem. This is fun.
And I can't wait to get my book.
Yay.
Yeah, are you on the Twitter?
Oh, me?
Yeah, can people track you down there?
Yeah, I have two Twitters, Introducing Emy, which is just all me, and then Trying Human, if you
want to do
human stuff.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay, cool.
I should have separated them in the beginning. Now it's too far gone.
Yeah. Now you're just Grimerica.
Exactly. And when I piss people off, I'm Graham, and when I don't, I'm Darren. Okay, Emy, thanks a lot for coming on the show. Let us know when the book goes on sale. Again, we encourage everyone to head over and check that out. And thanks for listening. Thanks for coming on the show.
Yay.
Right on.
Clear.
Can we talk?
We can.
Yep.
Okay. Yeah, we can. Oof,
the chat room is still on.
The chat room's still on, yeah.
That's okay. Wee, that was fun.
Yeah, thank you so much.
That was good.
Awesome.
Yeah.
If you guys ever do just like a general like UFO thing ever again, that would be so cool. Could I like talk again? If you guys ever do anything again.
Yeah, totally. We do like a Passport to Grimerica episode where we have listeners and stuff call in and we talk to them and then we put it out there.
Because it's so nice to like talk to people about aliens and UFOs. I have like nobody to talk to about it, so...
I know. It's crazy. That's one of the reasons I like to do this show, because I love talking with like-minded people.
Graham does a UFO quote every week, which we didn't do.
Yeah, we haven't done it yet.
The Expanded Perspectives intro.
No, because we're doing it later on, remember?
The outro? So if everyone will think we forgot, then surprise,
bitches.
What's
your quote going to be?
I don't know. I haven't picked it yet.
I got one.
Okay.
Don't be a ufologist. Don't be an apologist. Ufologist. Tell it like it is. Stan Friedman.
Oh, that's a good one. Yeah, I've got a...
That's better than no, I'm not signing your fucking book.
God, I'm depressed.
Yeah. So yeah, we really like to talk about UFOs around here. Amongst the many other strange topics on the fringe.
Yeah, I'm not just like a UFO person, but I kind of promote it more heavily because of Trying Human, so
yeah.
Sweet. We finally did our first Bigfoot episode. That's not released yet though.
Oh. Who were you talking to before me? You mentioned it real quick. something like Experience.
Expanded Perspectives. That's another podcast. We had them on to help plug their new thing they're coming out with. And then before that was
Martin Blank.
Yeah, talking about killer Wi-Fi.
Killer Wi-Fi, like,
yeah, the damaging effects of EMF and stuff.
Can they like show that? Can they prove that?
Yeah, apparently.
Yeah, he says he can. It was pretty depressing.
Now I feel obligated to turn my iPhone onto airplane mode when I go to bed and unplug my Wi-Fi and all this.
Like, how many tinfoil hats do I need?
That's what I said. I said, well, should I just sleep in a Faraday cage or?
You'll be like the boy in the bubble.
Yeah, the bubble boy.
You could get I wonder if you could just get like copper shingles and copper siding.
Yeah, or maybe just wear like copper lace clothing.
Don't live in Detroit. Your house will get stripped.
Oh, yeah, yeah.
I think I'm just going to get Wi-Fi protective paint and do my room in that.
Is that a thing? Or did you just make that up?
No, he talked about it. I remember hearing about that years ago.
What's in it? Like
probably lead. No.
Snake oil. Yeah. Oh, yeah, it's lead.
Leftover paint from the 60s.
The Wi-Fi can't get in, but I can't fucking count past 12 anymore.
You going to drink some mercury while you're at it? Make a little asbestos sandwich?
Alrighty, well, we should wrap this thing up, eh, Darren? It's getting late here.
Yeah. Wow, that was Canadian. That was super.
Was it?
Yeah, Adair.
Hey, Darren. Oh, jeez.
Even later for Red.
Oh, yeah. Almost midnight here.
Right, or suck some sulfur. I'm assuming I missed something.
No, we're talking about the, you know, the lead and the mercury.
Oh, and sucking sulfur?
Yeah.
I suck a little sulfur a few times a day. I think there's sulfur in cigarettes, isn't there?
Probably.
Everything else is in there.
Tar.
So, yeah, we'll send this to you, too. And you can forward it to all your... You can tweet it and put it out there.
I'll tweet it, too.
Yeah, please.
When do you think it will be out?
Yeah.
Darren?
Oof.
A couple weeks.
2016.
Really. No, while we're kind of jamming some extra episodes out right now because I've got so many, but within a month for sure.
Okay, cool.
It'll beat that. We're gonna do a double episode with somebody else who did a comic book about in the beginning, like the Anunnaki and the Nephilim and all that kind of stuff.
Ooh.
So in the beginning, I think it's called
Alex Teplish, okay. Right?
Alex Teplish. Have you ever heard of him?
No, I'll have to look at it though. Yeah. That's really cool.
Yeah, and then you can join us in the chat room.
Yay.
All right, Red, thanks for coming aboard, buddy. Oh,
yeah, one more thing. Here's the link to the McLelland blog post, you know, the one about the past life progression.
Oh, cool. Where?
Well, nothing more for me.
Okay.
Okay.
All right, guys. All right.
Yep, I'll see you later.
Okay, bye.
Okay, bye, guys.
Bye.
Take care, guys.
Okay, bye. Welcome back to Grimerica. That was our chat with Emy Bitner and Alex Teplish.
Yeah, yeah, good times. They were both pretty good. You guys should check out their work. All the graphics on both of them are fucking cool.
Yeah, Yeah, and the storylines,
yeah,
too, man.
Yeah, ancient, it's all right up your
ancient astronauts
alley.
And abductions.
Can't beat it. Hopefully that one comes out as a movie. I'd like to see that.
Yeah.
I'm surprised there hasn't been a fucking Ancient Aliens movie yet. Oh, I guess fucking what's it called? It's like an Ancient Aliens
Prometheus?
Movie. But they don't really, you know, that's like a 10-second thing at the beginning and then out the window. I want to see one that actually goes back, shows a creation.
Well, like Alex was saying, there's like, what, 50,000, what was it, 50,000 sites to be uncovered still in Iraq alone? That's, I don't know, that's hard to believe.
There could be more in Turkey. Turkey might be older than Iraq.
Fuck, imagine all the shit we're going to find still.
Yeah, Mom, telling you. Or we won't find because we'll be fucking gone. Or too busy to be worrying about digging up cities.
Too bad you have to use a toothbrush to get all that shit dug up, eh?
Fuck that, man. Dynamite and backhoes. Then when you find something, you can start going slow. Ish.
Slow-ish.
I mean, whatever. Fuck, you might... So you break a piece off, glue it back on.
It's true. There should be some technology to to put some of the shit back together, right?
Let's
move forward faster here.
Exactly. I say, or just fucking, just...
Or use more of that...
blow the doors off the fucking Great Pyramid, man. Why not? Let's start blowing some holes in that motherfucker.
No, it's under the Sphinx, man, where the...
That too?
Where the library is.
Or, if we can't do that, let's fucking excavate underneath from the side or something.
Yeah.
Fucking time to start risking some shit on this shit.
Start using their ground penetrating radar and find out what's really down there and just go hard.
Yeah, exactly. Here. We should start a petition. If the Death Star can get fucking 30,000 votes or signatures, then we should be able to get a few. So, we're coming to you from vacation. Well, not technically, but. Well, I'm on vacation right now.
Yeah, I'm working my ass off.
You're still working.
Yeah.
I'm on vacation.
Yeah.
Probably getting ready for my sister's wedding.
Oh, that's why you're going back there. Sweet.
Yeah. So this is like a little time machine or something like that.
Yeah.
Not really.
So anyways, we want to say thanks for listening and thanks to Emy and Alex.
Yeah, for coming on the show. Yeah. Thanks for RPJ for joining us with Emy.
Yeah.
He's the one who made the connection there.
That's right.
Hometown hero, RPJ. As always, review the show, grimerica.ca/iTunes. Check out the Money Bomb, grimerica.ca/moneybomb. And give somebody a hug today.
Spamgram, did you say that?
Oh, yeah, and Spamgram. See, now you just...
I can't believe I'm...
I wanted to go out on the fucking hug thing, but now you just went out on a little self-promotion.
Well,
shameless self-promotion.
You always ask me to read it, and if I don't have any, then I can't... I kind of get caught off guard, right?
Spam Graham with some hugs.
That's better. How's that? That's good. Some cosmic love.
And forward him your penis enlargement spam.
Not like I need it.
Okay. Thanks for listening, guys. We will see you next week. Just make me